Life will always bring you on a rollercoaster ride. I'm navigating through each and every day and loving what is and what the future may hold. My past has given me amazing memories and untold stories, and at times feeling of worry and hardship, which I now see as part of my life journey. Remember, show up, and if you fail, that's okay. Tomorrow will bring a new day and new ideas. I've had the privilege to spend time and interview some amazing leaders over the years. As they share their stories of life and business, I find out what makes them the people they are. I'm honored to share their stories with you.
On this week's show, we have Susan Ibitz. Susan is a human behavior hacker and lead research trainer at Human Behavior Lab. She has 26 years of experience in micro-expression, body language, deception, detection, statement analysis, face reading, and personality types.
Susan Ibitz, how are you?
Great. How are you doing?
I'm wonderful. Susan, we've had some great guests on this show, people that are masters of negotiating. We've had Bill Phillips, we've had Joseph Maguire, we've had Chris Voss as well on the show. And I would have to say, you are in this category of superstars. Not only can you help people with their negotiating skills, you can actually understand how to read faces, what people are saying with those micro little movements when in their face, and also what words they are using as well.
Well, I would say, first of all, thank you very much. I know Joseph, and I read his book. He sent it to me, signed it, and I really appreciate it. I try to keep all the people that I really like their books on my library signed, and I never allowed to anybody touch them. Thank you very much for putting me in that category. And I must say that I love my profession, my career, because for me it's a hobby with a paycheck. I always say, I never go to work, I go to have fun, and I'm going to bring money onto. So it's perfect. But I would say too, it's a gift and it's a curse. You never say to anyone as soon as you met them what you do for a living, because believe me, people run away from you. Yes. It's happened to me going on dates, and guys, when they ask me what I do for a living and I explain what I do, and says, okay, I'm going to go to the men's room. Like, okay, goodbye. I know you're not coming back. So yeah.
It's like telling people that you work for the IRS or something, you know, out the door.
I would say if I says I'm a serial killer, work for the IRS, I don't know, whatever, is going to be taken better. Because if I work for the IRS, people would ask me for advice. If I'm a serial killer, believe me, everybody has somebody who hate and want to take care of. But being a profiler and being able to read you and see you, even when I don't know you in person, I think is way more intimidated. And as you say it, I do the four channels, and for people who maybe has hear them separated, I'm going to do a little intro. I do micro expressions, who has been with us from 60, 70 years, who are 7 micro expressions, who are universal. Everybody cultural wise, race wise, have the same micro expressions. We have body language, who has been with us for a long, long time. Some people call it body language. Some people call it how we express ourselves with the body. It's not worldwide. It's not internationally. Some things that we do with our body and hands can be misunderstood in different continents.
That's a culture.
And believe me, I study in Manchester in UK, and I get in a lot of trouble for my sense of humor and way to express, until somebody was having pity enough of me and says, okay, I need to explain you what you're doing wrong. And I says, why? Everything. And that was a really good cultural shock. And I started learning more about cultural differences, and I do a lot of speech about that and what to do and not to do.
Okay.
And I do a statement analysis, or forensic analysis is the study of for example, anonymous letter, I can determine if the person is a woman, age, education, and sometimes even we can determine who is the person who wrote the letter. Because even if you don't want to, when we write anonymous letters, we sign it one way or another. And the other way is the statement analysis, who is analyzing in real time or through a statement that you wrote, who can be an email, a text, when you lie and how you lie, or when you try to omit things, and when and how I can direct conversations to you. And finally, face reading of physiognomy, who has been with us for 5,000 years. The Chinese has started when they need to diagnose women and they cannot touch it. They realize that everything it's right in your face, and that's how they use it. So yes, that's what I do. It's kind of wicked, but it's fun.
It is fun because, you know, if you look at Alexander the Great was using face reading to pick out his soldiers for people who would fit the perfect model for the army. Going through, then we look at how people use body language in the Western world for negotiation and in the sales process, or even watching people at a bar or watching people, you know, in the street and seeing how they look and seeing who's confident and who's not. And then what really fascinates me is that being able to use or understand or listen to people's words. We know about NLP, about if people say they see or they want you to, you know, look, and how people will express themselves.
Oh, I can spot people in a crowd that they seem weird to me. Weird meaning that they're different or they're acting different than how the crowd is going. So yes, it's I'm sorry. It's been a journey, and I can see things different. And yeah, you can catch people on conversations or text message. Even you can know if somebody is depressed or not. For example, I'm going to ask you something. I'm going to put you in a little spot and you forget me. How much of your communication is body language?
Well, it's about 80%, 80, 90%.
We have this part of the communication who can we centralize, and 93% is body language and only 7% is words. Since the 2000, a lot of people has been doing studies, and I completely agree with that today communication happen through the phone, through text and emails. So body language and micro expression are great when you have the person in front of you.
Yes, but you also can tell how someone is feeling but in an email that someone has sent you. You can take a step back, wait a while, and then respond to that text message or that email when you're not as riled from the original time of reading.
Actually, that is a statement analysis. That's what I say, that I believe people need to do the four channels. In personally, when I start doing this professionally, says I cannot do one without the other, because in an era where we have phone and we can communicate through continents like we're doing now, different time zone, and we can talk at the same time, we need to understand the words, and we need to know if I can see your face. You can find everybody on the media today. So if I can see your face and determine three basic stuff, how you intake information through your ears, how you process information through your eyebrows, and how friendly is your proxemic, who is the distance between your eyelid and your eyebrow. And I know if you're audit, if you're visual, if you need facts and data, if you need studies to reinforce what I'm telling you, or if you're a people person. And that the way I can initiate a conversation who can take us to meet in person, or maybe I do a Skype where I can use body language and micro expression. I don't say body language and micro expression need to be left aside, but today we have a new world where salespeople, remember the salespeople a couple of years ago, they used to go door by door. People used to travel continents to meet with a client. Today, doesn't happen anymore. We need to rethink this.
Yeah, because everything is coming either audio or video. The precious thing that we have is time. And people want, I think as society moves forward, everybody wants everything instantly, you know, instant likes, instant gratification. It's all, so if you, knowing the skills that you have and then showing them to someone in sales or negotiation, gives them the upper hand, because knowing if they have a picture of that person, they can steer the conversation. Is it persuasion? Is it manipulation if it's used wrong into the result that they actually want at the end?
I always go to my classes with toolbox, an orange toolbox, and I have a hammer inside the toolbox. And people freaked out and says, okay, what I have in my hand? And I said, it's a hammer. Okay. And I show a picture and says, who is this person? Well, this person was called the Hammer in 1973. He was a serial killer. And I show another picture of a person with a hammer rebuilding places where hurricanes has devastated the town. So it's not the tool that I give you, it's how you use it. I can give you a car and you can kill someone or you can save someone. So I always, when people says, oh, you're teaching people how to manipulate others. Like, no, I teach people how to better communicate. If I can help a husband and a wife to understand each other without the conflict, because we can understand that we have different ways to intake information and process, you're not manipulating your partner. You're communicating as the other person needs to perceive information, not as how you need to perceive it. Because the first problem I encounter when I'm training or do lectures or presentation or I teach my students in the university is how you want to receive information, facts and data. Well, the person you have in front of you is a human, is people-oriented. So if you give them facts and data, but you don't tell a story, you lost that person. So we need to understand that we need to make two parts on a conversation, the way we need to communicate and the way we need to communicate the other. And it's important to tell others how we need to be addressed to not get lost. So I think if we can put all this together, we have a huge improvement. But I agree, can be used as a manipulation if it's used on the dark side and it's been used in politics. I did a lot of politics, but I determine what is the line I cross.
Yeah, it's like sales training. You know, if you just get into the basic sales training, it's persuasion. And again, you can use it by handing objections and looping back to drive a person into a corner. So I think the person that has it, that we teach or that we speak to, ethically transparent in their own way as well.
Yeah, for example, I'm going to give you another exercise that I do. You know what? I decided as a New Year revolution to stop smoking. Do you think I stopped smoking or I didn't stop smoking?
You're lying.
Why?
Because you said as it is happening now instead of the past tense.
Actually, the trick is in another word.
Okay.
I decide to go for dinner and I stop there. What about if I ask you, and what did you decide? And I need to reply, well, I decide to go for dinner, but I found out that I have leftover pizza on the fridge, so I stay home.
So it's a continue on. It's the continue on of the conversation. So
that's
so,
another trick. That's another thing that I can sometimes fight with people. One is that our body language is not 93% of the communication today. It's smaller, and we need to readapt. And another one is people do not lie. You allow people to lie you. We don't pay attention to the tone. We don't pay attention to the words we use and the other people use. So if you make the right questions, it's impossible somebody else can lie to you.
Okay, so we do understand and we know that tonality plays a big part in it as well. So if, say someone was late or someone stood you up, and if you said to them, oh, I'm sorry, I can't make it because I missed the bus, Are they lying there, or would they say it in a different way?
I will rephrase the question and go back to the front and from the middle and like, oh yeah, you missed the bus. What bus you usually take? What time is the bus you usually take? So you know the driver. So I would make questions like that to elicitate an answer to a point where like, okay, I didn't miss the bus. I forget to snooze the clock. So give me a break.
Yeah, because well, what's happening there is it's usually people will give you three objections. The first two objections will be sort of smoke screens. The third one will normally be the true objection, because after that, the brain can't really commute, because it's going, the subconscious mind is going, think quickly on your feet. This is a lie. Quick, you're going to get caught. Be honest. And you have an explosion.
Yeah, because the brain go to a cognitive overload. It takes 30% more brain matter to lie than say the truth. So I always say to people, if you need to lie, and I want to be clear, because I lie, you lie, everybody lie. I actually make my first lie of the day, and I'm going to give you the example. You need to give a 70% true and a 30% lie. And why I lie today? Because I was walking my dog in the park, and he have a spot on the chest, and the people ask me, hey, what happened with Homer? Oh, nothing. We take it to the groomer and they made a mistake. No, he need to get a biopsy done. But I didn't have emotional time, physical time to talk about it. And I didn't want to talk about it because I really sat regarding what is going to happen. So I did lie. Yes. Why I lie? Because I didn't want to confront the situation. It's like when maybe your wife says, oh, I love this dress. What do you think? And you know the happy wife is happy life. Well, so yeah. If she wearing that dress make her happy and give you peace of mind that evening, you says, oh, you look lovely on it. You gonna wear it? Because actually, a lie is a statement where reality information, facts are not shared or purposely hide or misinformed. So when I say that, people ask me, well, what about an actor? Well, we know they're not lying to you. You pay for a ticket and they're performing a role. They've been paid to be that person, and you are acknowledged, and that person is not, I don't know, Al Pacino never was a mob. Meryl Streep never was an editor in New York from a fashion magazine. So we know, we go to the cinema believing in that. But when people lie to you, I think it's two reasons. Avoid conflict and gain advantage. What do you think?
It depends, because sometimes if you may lie to someone, like you said about your dog, the reason why you suggest that lie is to, because you don't want to get into the whole conversation about, oh, we had to bring here. It's like if someone says to you, I've given up smoking, and they go, oh, how long have you given up smoking? And they go on and on and on about the smoking. But if you say to someone, I don't smoke, they don't ask you about all the 50 questions about why you don't smoke. So I believe we can lie just because if we're not bothered to get into a full conversation. And on other times we will lie to show the person that we're not weak in any way. Would that be it?
Yeah, actually, when you need to go, basically in the work on dating, I always says that work and dating are so similar. You need to be like, and you need to show yourself at this, the best part of yourself in different ways. And works, you have a meeting, or your boss says, hey, we have this huge project. It's going to bring a lot of money. Are you capable to do it? I'm like, oh, yes, I studied that in the university. And you run to the library to see accounting for dummies because you don't have any idea what you're getting into. So, okay. Yes, obviously, that is misrepresentation or misinterpreting events or misinterpreting yourself, that you're capable to do something that you're not. It's like when you go in dating and you met a exquisite lady and she says, oh, I love horse riding. And she says, I would love to meet someone who does horse riding with me on Sundays, and you twist your face and says, I love it too. So you go home and start looking for who of your friends know how to do it so you can practice for the next date.
Yeah.
It's a white light. So even the person with higher energy, you can baseline somebody in 50 seconds. Sometimes I take an Uber or a Lyft, and I do love to have open conversation. Even though I'm an introvert, you learn from people. So I try to talk to them. And you can make a baseline in like 50 seconds, a minute and a half. People think that you need an hour or 2 days to be in a baseline. No, you don't. It's easy.
Okay. Well, there you talk about people having big ears and people having small ears and how they perceive information. Can you have a big-eared person who's an introvert and a small-eared person that's an introvert and getting mixed messages?
Mixed messages or how they communicate?
How they communicate.
Well, we have four type of introverts. If it's a social introvert, it's an anxiety introvert, it's a different too. So I would say that I don't think that introversion is going to modify how the person need to receive information. The way the people is going to give you information has to do with the way they process the eyebrows and the way that the lower part of the face.
Okay.
So ears is intake. If you have small ears, I need to show you. I need to show you a product. I need to talk to you on images. Can you look this? For example, I sign my emails, even I'm going to talk to you and says, I see you later. I'm not going to see you, but because I'm a visual person. So it's a person who need to be stimulated all the time. But the other problem is they can have too much stimulation, so they need to be apart. When they go into a restaurant, they need to be facing the wall because they can get distracted because they have this shiny ball syndrome. A person with big ears is going to listen to you because the sound board is big. They need consistency. So if you want to get to the heart or convince to sell a product with somebody who have big ear, be consistent. Don't change your phrases. Don't change the person who is in contact with this person with big ears, because if he or she like it, if you change it, you lost the consistency. Now, how you're going to talk to me has to do again with eyebrows and the chin.
Okay, so what about the eyebrows? So say you're speaking to a woman and you can't distinguish her eyes, or a guy with long hair, or not their ears, because of their hair is hiding. You're saying then you'd look at their eyebrows and their chin to figure out how you should negotiate with them.
If I cannot see the ears, who happen a lot, I try to at least know if they're low or high. High, they take information really fast. Low ears take information slowly and they need more time to process. So pointy eyebrows. Pointy eyebrows is a person who going to need information to be back up. They want to be right. You need to talk to them and let them be right on the conversation. And they want to be right based on facts and data. So probably I'm going to approach to this person and give the information. I'm going to offer complimentary information regarding a manual, studies done, university who has working with, or other people, referrals from other people who had used the product if we're talking about selling something. So referral and testimonials are going to be really important because this person is going to do all the research you can imagine. Now, if I have a person who have round eyebrows, I will go to tell a story. I will say who you said, how you said, how this person changed his life or her life based on the use of these products, how comfortable you felt when that person come back telling you the story and how good it was, and that person want to feel comfortable around you, to try to make it feel friendly but not to be a foe. And if you have a person who have a straight eyebrows, it's a person who needs facts and data. So give it a bullet point, be concrete. That's what he does. That's how much it's going to cost. And that's when it's going to be delivered. You need any more information? Tell me what do you need and I'm going to deliver it to you. I always use the analogy of the king. A person with with straight eyebrows is going to say the king and queen die. A person with pointy eyebrows is going to say the king and queen die. The queen have a heart attack and the king die from pain on the heart. And these are the studies who show from the Cardiology Association how many people can have the same disease. Now, a person with round eyebrows is going to say the king and queen die. She was the love of his life. He couldn't put up with losing her. So suddenly, after 6 months to passing, crying and being dark, he finally died and met her love. So it's a story. That's how you will approach people with different eyebrows.
Okay. And then the chin.
Ooh, chin, actually, it's a trick. I shouldn't have said chin because I always ended up saying this. The chin on a person can determine the stamina on private moments from men and women. So the chin is an interested part of the face. Actually, when I do dating or I teach people how to read faces for dating and I go to the chin, it's like where we spend most time. A small chin is going to be a person who is more susceptible. And a big chin is going to be like a bulldog. It's going to bite it and go for it and is not going to give up. Instead, a person with a small chin is more susceptible. It's more prone to maybe be irritated for small things. But it's important to see if they have a cliff. They have a line, a little line in the middle.
Yeah,
because that make a person playful. So that is a compliment or a constellation, how we call it, when you have two features in one that can ease. If a person have a big chin, but have a big cliff, like a big indentation on the bottom of the chin, that person is aggressive on business, but can be playful too. So you're going to work really hard with that person, but you're going to have fun. Forehead is the way you process. It's the way how you process information regarding how you interact. Like a flat forehead is a person who is like an engineer, follows steps. A person who is round forehead, it's a person who is more on the creative side. I always say, if you're going to choose somebody to do customer service or sales, choose somebody who have the major quantity of round features in your face. It's like when you see a baby. We get drawn to babies because they have this round, cutest face. It's for that reason. Round mean nurture, mean trust, mean mother, mean feel comfortable. Pointy, if you start thinking about all the witches on all the movies, you're going to see they have pointy nose, pointy eyebrows, and pointy chins, and those long, bony faces.
What about dimples?
I always say people who is empathetic and sympathetic, it's easy reading dimples than I am. I would say this is one of my weakness, maybe because some people is more on the Chinese spiritual part of face reading and things like that. I'm more on the hardcore of this, so it's more difficult to be an empath. Dimples, depending on the part of your face where are located, they mean things too. They say that if you have a dimple on the ball of your nose, you're falling in love with everything. So it's easy to you to sell you a car, a house, and a partner. But I always say, yeah, when people do sales, if you find a person who have a round top of the nose and have a dimple on the nose, like a line who cannot divide the nose, that person is easy to fall in love with everything that you put in front of them if you know how to sell it right.
Yes, but Susan, also, do you know who the easiest person to sell to is?
Which?
A salesperson.
You know what? You're right. Because they compete each other to see who is.
Yeah, the easiest people to sell to are salespeople. People, because they were buying into what you were saying, because they're doing it every day, and you were triggering words and stimulating their mind as they would other people. So it was sort of tripping into that subconscious.
Do you know, now you mentioned a car salesman. One of the things that I have so much fun doing is here in Chicago on Sundays, a lot of car dealers, they have pasta, they have hamburgers, they have vans to bring people to buy cars. And near to the end of the year, when they need to get rid of the inventory, you have a lot. And I love to walk between the salespeople and see how they sell. It's an art. Selling cars today is an art. And you can learn so much from a sales car person when they're doing the deal. It's magic. I cannot stop seeing them or listen to them.
I did it for 10 years plus. I know the art of selling very well, very well.
If you can sell a car, you can sell anything.
Well, if you can, I used to sell office equipment and stationery and printing. And there is, if you can sell photocopiers, you can sell anything. Believe me.
Oh, my God, you're danger.
Yes.
Remind me not to buy any product from you.
Oh, don't say that. Least. My God, it's all this, but it is everything that I realize that it's only offered to the person because I want to help them. And there's one thing with a lot of my clients who hate selling. I have to get them into the frame of mind to say that they aren't selling, but they are actually helping. Because when I get them to say that they are helping someone, their whole mindset changes and they do better.
How do you think that the people need to believe what they sell in? Because I found out most people, when they have problem selling something, is when they don't believe on that.
Yeah, because it's passion. You need to believe in what you're doing and what you're saying. If you don't, you're ethically doing something wrong and all you're doing is chasing the money, and that will get you nowhere. However, if you are selling something and you have the passion and belief, that oozes through. And you know, there's something in our subconscious mind that picks up fear, and you can pick that up fairly quickly. So if the person is passionate about what they do and they love what they do, and you bring that across the table to the other person realizes that and knows that they're trying to help them. They're not trying to push it on them.
Oh, I agree. I always says that I pick up my fights, and if I'm in a networking or an environment when I need to introduce myself and people ask me what I do and says, oh, that is BS. Like, okay, thank you for your opinion, and I excuse myself. Why? Because if the other person is not open or don't believe in what I do or don't respect what I do, it's a person that I cannot communicate.
Watch the hands, the palms of the hands that are open.
That's what we look first when we met someone. If you met someone who have the hands on the pocket or on the back of the body,
yeah,
and they approach to you, you get in a defensive position. So I always says, believe it or not, people think are the eyes or the face, but the first things that we saw is the hands, because we have this genetic memory that and Precambric years, if a person doesn't show the hands, can have a gun or have a rock or something to hurt you. So always approach, like you says, perfectly done. You always approach someone with the hands open and never the hand like Hitler position, always the hand offering, yeah, like when you met a dog and you want the dog to lick your hand, is the same way.
Well, it's a case of, it is, you know, the clenched fists are, if someone's coming to you, go easy, calm down, relax, and you have the palms of the hands and the fingers fully stretched out, and you're going, calm down, relax. And the body language, it tells so much when in negotiation. And here, I want to ask you something. Objections. in a process, mm-hmm. if someone has an objection, what sort of words should one look for if they're trying to close a deal and get money off someone? What should you look for to see if the person is interested or not interested?
The first thing I would say is when you address the price, look on the face and the body. If the person shows surprise, if the person shows fears, or the person shows disgust, dislike. So it's really different. If the person feel anger, it's because you're way over the price, so you're not done selling the same way that if shows surprise, is like, oh, you caught it on a bad point, but he's not angry yet. You can still sell this. If a person show dislike, is because is way out of his range or her range and wasn't what this person expected. So first scenario, if the person is angry, you need to address it without being aggressive. It's like, okay, obviously it's not working for you. What will work for you? Tell me what are the expectations you have. Tell me where are the parameters you have, the time that you have to think about it. It's anything else I can give you, offer you to reinforce the product. You want to talk to somebody else. You want to hear another customers who use it. You want to see the manual. So it's important to see the expression on the face. And when that expression come back again, when you repeat the number, you need to go back and reinforce. But most of the time, sometimes it's not has to do with the number you give the person, because if the person walk to you or the person is talking to you, have an approximate idea what is the cost of the product, because everybody Googled today. So it's an idea on the price. So maybe it's that you haven't marked all the potential, you haven't marked all the features. I always give the price in the middle, and when I give the price, it's different than says, oh, it's 7,000. I doubt it. Oh, it's 7,000 and coming with all these features. So I put the advantage and the bonus after the price. If the person have high eyebrows, it's a person who need time to process information. And if the person have low distance between the eyelids and the eyebrows, it's a person who going to jump on decisions. For example, person who going to buy a car who have high eyebrows is going to do the research, is going to look for the color, is going to look for where she gone or he going to go to buy the car. The process is going to be almost done before this person get to the auto showroom. Now, the person who have short distance between the eyelids and the eyebrows is going to be more impulsive. If the place close at 4, is going to show 3:30, and you can sell anything to that person. You can push it, jump it, work the ego, get friendly, and that person is going to leave with the car. Now, if the person have high eyebrows, that person maybe says, oh, I can afford it, I love it, can you give me the information? Don't discard that person can come back tomorrow or the day after to buy the car. They only need more time. So again, we can mix features. Again, when I says you need the 4 channels, yeah, because in the words doesn't say anything. I would say on that phrase, you don't have anything to analyze. What you have to analyze is the face, the body when he's saying, and the micro expressions when he said, or micro or macro expressions when that person said.
We're coming to the end of the show. I'm going to ask you a couple of questions, as I ask all my guests, and it's the best business advice you have ever received.
I think the best one, and I keep telling everybody that I can, is pick your customers before you pick your business. It's people who's going to hate what you do. Do not pick your fight. Yeah. If they don't like it, they don't get it, move on. It's going to be problems. So pick your customers before you pick your business.
Yeah. I always say, if you don't get it, move on. Find someone that does get it. Yeah.
We're on the same page.
Best book that you would recommend for someone to read?
But I would tell you the first book that opened my mind, it's The Name of the Rose by Umberto Eco and who took me to who I am today. So it's not directly related to my profession because I read everything. But I think it was an amazing book.
What song would you like us to play out with today?
On My Way from by Frank Sinatra. My father always told me, you're stubborn, you always get your way. You should pair with Frank Sinatra. And I love it. I think it's describe me.
And where can people locate you if people want to reach out to you, Susan, and use your services or pick your brain on something?
We have a website who is humanbehaviorlab.com. We are pretty active in social media. We publish almost daily. If it's not humor things, because sometimes work is too heavy, so laughing about things is good. You can find us on LinkedIn. We do articles. We're going to start a YouTube channel pretty soon. I think in next 2 weeks that we are ready to edit in videos, so you can see us. For the visual people, you can see us, and for the auditory people, you can read us.
Brilliant. And the website address?
humanbehaviorlab.com.
Awesome. Susan, it's been a pleasure having you on Breakthrough Brands. I wish you all the best, and we shall talk soon.
Thank you very much for having me, and I hope the next one it's local and we can go for a pint after the show.
Yes, we'll have a good pint, and hopefully we'll get to do a talk sometime in 2019.
Let's do it.
Take care. God bless.
You too. Bye.
And now the end is near. So I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full. I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Regrets I've had a few, but then again.
Are you being authentic and unique in everything you do, or are you living a life that others expect of you? It's time to step up and shine. Be the real you, stir that great awakening inside, and trust the process. Want to know how you can do this? Go to joedalton.ie/discover.